Divine Truth. Name of this presentation is Femininity and Masculinity, and it is part of Discussion with Jesus and Mary series. It was presented at Summerfest in Kentucky, New South Wales, Australia, on the 2nd of December, 2012.
We have our cool change. Maybe. We might not get much rain out of it, mind you. It's all north of us, isn't it? North of us, not a good thing.
North of us is a good thing for home. Not a good thing for here. Yeah. So how's everyone doing today? Good? Hey? It was a difficult day, was it? Is that how you feel, Matt? Difficult day. I enjoyed today. It was good. I felt, though, that quite a few got out of themselves a bit after my chat with you this morning. And it took you a while to get back in, didn't it? But one of the things I'd like to talk about with you tonight is just what I've noticed about masculinity and femininity while I've been with you for this week. Sound all right? Because it's interesting to see what happens with masculinity and femininity and how they work together, or in our case, how they work apart quite well. So it's something we need to address. But it's very interesting because a lot of the work that we've had to do or redo this week has been a result of the conflict between masculinity and femininity. So just to give you a bit of an example, I remember on the first day when we started doing the fertility holes and the ponding systems, if you have a look at the ponds were out of level. And it was interesting because Peter did one of the ponds himself, and the pond that Peter did was almost completely level. And he didn't put a water level on it or anything like that. He just did the pond with the crawler and got it pretty much completely level. Almost right across the entire wall, it was completely level. And then, okay, better have my glasses just so I can see everybody who puts their hand up. They're a bit dirty, so I better do that too. And what happened then was that he also oversaw the second one as well, which was right up the top on the right-hand side. And that was also pretty close to level. And then he handed it over to his workers. Now, his workers are very male-dominant men. They actually only see women as having two roles, probably, from what I can gather in my own interactions with them. One of the roles is to cook for them, and the other one is to have sex with them. And there's really not much else that they feel that women are useful for, particularly on the land. And so they have a very strong feeling about male dominance. As a result of that, every single hole they did was dominant on the right-hand side by a metre over the left-hand side, which actually meant that every single one of those holes, pond holes, if we'd allowed them to stay as they were, would have breached through the middle of the dam wall, and we would have ended up with four breached dams from what they built. If they had more of an evenness with regard to their opinions of masculinity and femininity, they would have automatically have done the left side at an even level, and therefore there would have been no problem with the holes breaching. Now, as you know, it's taken us almost 2 days, and we're still not finished, fixing that problem. So because of, in this case, the male's dominance and his attitude towards the feminine, even when he's working with the machinery, he's already displaying this male dominance. He's thinking he's doing a logical thing, but the reality is he's producing a pond that's never going to hold water. It's going to breach the very first time that it's full. So as soon as it gets full, it'll breach. And as soon as it breaches, you pretty much can kiss goodbye the entire pond, because it'll erode immediately down to the base, pretty much, and then it's a pretty hard job to fix after that. So we would have had four breached ponds if we didn't address this issue of the imbalance of the holes. And that imbalance was created completely because of a male dominant attitude. Now, it's interesting that Peter, when he saw these holes, he said, "I feel they're out of level, guys." And they basically dismissed him. They felt it was all level, it was all fine, it was all going to be okay, and so forth. So he could see, Peter could see some of the lack of level, but unfortunately, his own workers wouldn't see it. Now, Pete there also had some emotion of not addressing the issue. You see, what happens is if you allow an issue to go on unaddressed, you just finish up creating more work for yourself. So if you don't address an issue right at the beginning and you give a person a choice, they either follow your direction or they leave. That's the choice they have. And if you don't give them that choice and you give them the third choice, which is do what they want, right, then you're asking for different issues and problems in the future that you're going to have to fix. And this is a feeling that Pete's had for some time, that he has to go along afterwards and fix up what some of the workers that he has does for him. Does that make sense? And that is only happening because he's not able to actually give them the choice. You either do what I say or you leave. Does that make sense? And this is part of the issue, the fear of addressing a conflict. So many people have that. So then we proceed a little bit further through the days, and if we look even over the last 2 days, it's quite interesting what's happened at different times. If we look at what happened up at the garden area, for example, and today I was there with the garden team, and I noticed that they'd made this neat little path all the way through the garden, which was fine, but they'd laid down newspaper, and then they'd laid down the mulch exactly where the newspaper ended. But we were going to have to lay down newspaper all over the other area as well, which meant that someone else was going to have to come along and lift up that newspaper on their hands and knees and shove underneath another newspaper and do it the hard way, basically. Now, that happened even though Lincoln, who was the leader of the team, had given instructions twice not to do it. So we've got a male giving instructions, and it was mostly instructions given to women, and two times he'd given these same instructions, and yet in the end, oh, that's a nice breeze there. That's nice. You can't feel that, can you? Because you haven't got any. Yeah. It's beautiful. And what he'd done is he'd given these instructions quite clearly, but unfortunately, it went in there and out there, which is a bit of a worry because it means that there's nothing in there. Now, I say that in jest, but what I want to point out is this. It was a very illogical thing to do because it meant that somebody else was going to have to come along and do extra work. Now, men are usually quite good at logic and structure. Does that make sense? That is one of a masculine trait that is generally quite good. That when I say quite good, most men generally have it. Now, there are a lower number of men in this audience that have it, and the reason why is because many of you men are women dominant. In other words, you allow women to dominate you, right? And as a result of that, your logic goes out of the window at times. Does that make sense? But what happened was that everyone was going up to Lincoln. Many of the women were going up to Lincoln to get directions. They weren't going to Philippa to get directions. Now, this is very interesting too. Most of the people going to Lincoln to get directions were women. And yet, when he gave them the directions, it went in one ear and out the other. So why were they going to Lincoln? They obviously weren't going to Lincoln to get directions. They were going to Lincoln to get an addiction met with the male. You follow me? And then when Lincoln gives the directions and you know, twice he's given the same directions and they're not followed, Lincoln's then going, oh, I'm just going to have to come back later and do it myself, which is the feeling that he basically had. Why? Because he had some fear, as we discussed today, about actually addressing the women and the women potentially getting angry with him. Does that make sense? So there's again some stuff going on between the male and the female. In addition, many of the women had the emotion that what Lincoln was wanting them to do was not pretty enough. Right? Now, this is not a bad thing that you think about what's pretty enough, because the way God creates is that God creates with structure and with beauty. All right? Now, the structure is the masculine side of the creation process. Does that make sense? And the beauty is the feminine side of the creation process. So you look at what normally happens in the home, and there's a reason for this, and it's because of these masculine and feminine traits. What often happens in the home is a man will fix the thing in the home, but the woman will make it beautiful. The man has a focus on making it functional, the woman has a focus on making it beautiful. The problem, though, happens when one of those sides decides that it wishes to be dominant. So many of the women today working on that little project, as I discussed with them, or as I haven't discussed with them, that's why I'm discussing with them now, I discussed part of this with them, and many of the women working on that project had a focus on making it pretty without thinking about the functionality. That is an indication that you are female dominant and you want the male to be subservient. Right. If you were actually balanced with your approach towards the masculine and the feminine, you would have liked it to look good, but at the same time, you would have still retained functionality. Does that make sense? And this is what often does not happen when we're working in teams, because often it's a team of women or men working on something, and as a result, whatever is the dominant emotion or the dominant a feeling towards a certain gender, that is the feelings that will be dominant in the workplace. Does that make sense, Matt? Sorry? Has to go on. It's a very logical. Has to be turned on for a week.
Okay. Could, when you say dominant towards a certain gender, could you just explain that a little bit more, what you mean by that, AJ?
Well, for example, in this particular case with the garden, the dominant gender, if you like, was female. In other words, most of the men had a preference to serve the women, and most of the women had a preference to have the men serve the women. Right? And so that means then that the whole garden will start looking pretty without having functionality. See, if the two are equal, it would have functionality and beauty. But as soon as one gender gets dominant in the way they apply things, if they haven't got an openness to the other gender, then whatever the dominance is will be where the project goes. But unfortunately, as soon as it's out of balance, there's a great deal of likelihood that as soon as it's out of balance, the whole project will fail. So in the case of the ponds, for example, as soon as a masculine dominance arrives, there's now a tendency for the whole project to fail because the female side of the dam, if you like, is not built high enough. It can breach, and if it breaches, then the whole thing's failed. Right? Now, in their case, the male was dominant in his feelings towards the female. He wants to dominate the female. He wants to control the female. He wants to dictate what happens. And if you meet some of Peter's workers, you'll feel that quite strongly if you're a woman. You can feel how, and you can feel it if you're a man too. As soon as you have a sort of balanced viewpoint towards a woman, they view you as a weak man. Right? So they're masculine dominant. And as a result of that, the right side of the dam's high. As a result of that, the left side of the dam's low. As a result of that, there's a high likelihood of a breach. As a result of that, the whole project could fail. So can you see how you have this chain of events happen just because of something being dominant? If you look at what was going on with the pathway, like what would happen is that the women wanted it all nice and neat. Now, if the women did the next lay down of the paper without actually thinking about it, they would have laid the paper next to the other paper, which means there would have been a hole all the way along the side of the path, which means the cooch would have come up all through the side of the path, right, all the way around the entire path. And the path goes for quite a few metres, like 20 or 30 metres. You would have 20 or 30 metres of cooch line all alongside the path as a result, if we allowed that to continue. So can you see how if one side dominates the other, you start getting this imbalance? Down at the reptile farm, it was happening to a degree too. Many times when we plant, we want to get things beautiful right at the time we do it. Right? This is something that you ladies, because you often are not a practical, you're often thinking from a female dominance beautiful point of view. So when you do that, you want everything looking good as soon as you've finished it. Right? But if it's not functional, then you're going to have problems. To give you an example, there were certain plants that were planted very close together that were going to end up being this hot wide and 3 metres high, right next to a veggie garden that would be this high. Now, while the plants are this high, it all looks nice. But can you imagine what's going to happen 2 or 3 years' time? There's not going to be any veggies growing in that veggie garden, is there? Because it will all be blocked out by the light. Right? Now, it was interesting in this case, I know Peter mentioned that to Mum the previous night. He mentioned, Mum, perhaps things are a bit close. Just a suggestion. But because of the female dominance in that project, you get an ignoring of that comment. Does that make sense? And as a result of the ignoring of the comment, all those think plants get put together. Now extra work will be created down the track. Someone's got to come along and either prune it or we've got to replant the plants. That there's only two choices. Does that make sense? Yeah. So what happens when we do these kind of things is we don't realise that as soon as we get out of kilter with regard to masculinity and femininity, whatever we're working on together, there's a likelihood of the whole thing failing, not just a certain portion of it failing. And this is one of the things, this is why everything that God does is completely balanced with masculinity and femininity. Everything is completely stable and equal. There's not one side that wants to be dominant over the other. Right? God is focused on function as well as form. So you can think of it as structure as well as beauty. Not dishonouring one or the other. And when we dishonour one or the other, we are now creating projects that are going to potentially fail as a result of our dishonour of one or the other sides of the soul, if you like, because it is the soul, the complete soul that we're looking at. Does that make sense to everyone? So when you look at the different projects that go on and the different things that are going on, quite often we see different things happening and then they aren't addressed. So one of the things we're going to talk about with the leaders after this week has been finished, is the need to more quickly address issues where things are not working exactly as they wish them to work. Because the faster you address the issue, the faster people's emotional differences are addressed, the faster there is the potential to change. And it's interesting, as soon as I address that issue with the team, what did you ladies and fellows feel up there as soon as that issue was addressed? With regards to just the simple issue of the paper. Some of you were there. What did you feel? Can you be free to comment about it? That's a very interesting thing. This is Peter's sheep protector dog. He's come in for a visit. Sorry? Bluey, is it? He gets a bit frightened by the lightning, so he needs some company. So she, is it? Sorry. Yeah, she needs some company. Does anyone who was there want to comment about how you felt? If you, Matt, you got just right there.
I don't know if this is in line with what you're thinking, but it was like everybody worked together, everybody pulled their energy together, and we got the job done.
Yeah, and everyone enjoyed it a bit more too.
Oh, yeah. We did. It was really nice energy.
Yeah, as soon as that issue was addressed. See, as soon as you address an issue between the genders, both halves start to at the soul level feel the issue. As soon as they start to feel the issue, now there's more openness towards each other, now there's more cooperation. As soon as there's more cooperation, now the job can be done faster, quicker, with a lot more smoothness. Everyone understands what they're doing, so it makes it a lot easier. Does that make sense? Yep. Alexis? You went up there, though, so... Hey? You were down at the reptile farm at the time, weren't you? What number is it? Is it on? No. So the logic has just gone out the window, you see? It is. That's all it is. Can I say that? The logic goes out the window. What, if the logic's gone out the window, female dominance is what's going on. Like females wanting to suppress the male. That's what's happening. As soon as logic goes out the window, it's right there, twice, with both guys. Can you see? Yes. So this is the issue. You notice it all the time. You also notice when male dominance is around. It's a very, very powerful feeling when male dominance is around. You notice straight away. Pretty much everyone is sensitive to it too. Mm-hmm. And what it causes is a rift between the two halves of the soul. Now, if the two halves of the soul are working against each other, what do you think the final outcome's going to be? Pretty poor, isn't it? It's not going to be... But if both of the halves of the soul are working with each other, one supporting the other, so in other words, the male supporting the feminine drive to create and make things beautiful, and the female supporting the male's drive to make things structurally sound, to have function. If both of those things are happening at the same time, then we've got a beautiful outcome. Yeah, fire away.
Yeah, I don't know if this is my injury, but I was there. I went there after the snake farm.
Yep.
And the
feeling. The snake farm. Yeah.
Yeah. I call it the snake pit.
The snake pit.
Yeah. Yeah, but the feeling when I got up there was it wasn't making a lot of sense to me.
Yep.
And so I started getting tired, and I just didn't feel like I was able to give love to the process, so I left.
Yeah.
But I wasn't sure if that ties into what you were talking about.
Certainly it does.
And you were there talking to Lincoln and Philip at that time.
Yep. Yep.
And then, yeah, so...
Yep.
Yeah.
But certainly it does. Whenever something doesn't make sense to a person, generally they tire of something quite quickly.
Yeah.
Or you could have a desire to make sense of it.
Yeah. Yeah, I mean, I feel I'm pretty logic-based.
But you like to be spoon-fed.
Oh, okay. So that's why I left?
Yeah.
Yeah, okay. That's
whereas a person who doesn't want to be spoon-fed would say, what's going on here? Doesn't make any sense to me.
Yeah.
Can you tell me what's happening? You know what I mean?
Yeah, yeah.
A person who has a desire to know and who doesn't want to be spoon-fed would actually engage the process a lot more passionately, if you like.
Right, right, yeah.
Yeah. Yeah. Whereas when you come there, it makes no logical sense. Look at it all. Yeah, and then because no one's coming to you and meeting your demand emotionally, you then leave.
Mm.
And this is what I'm saying also, is that a lot of times this week, addictions are in play with who you see and what you spend time with and all those kind of things, you see? And many of these addictions surround what you get from the opposite gender. So many of your addictions are about what you get from the opposite gender or don't get, right? One of those two things. And whenever we have addictions in play with the opposite gender, as Lincoln found out today, he can say the words of giving direction. Beautiful. He can say the words of giving direction, but actually, nobody hear it because they're not hearing. They're not there to hear words. They're there to get feelings. And when the feelings ain't coming, then nobody hears anything. That make sense? And this is what we're often doing when we engage a process. We think we're there for the right reasons, but oftentimes we are there in the addiction, demanding or wanting something from the process. Does that make sense to everyone? And this is something we need to understand more clearly. So, Lincoln, you want to say?
So, if they weren't hearing what I was saying, was that I wasn't meeting the addiction they were
Well, there's two things going on. You may have been meeting their addiction already because they know they don't have to listen to you. And they knew that. They weren't going to get kicked out if they didn't listen to you. Because what was your decision? Your decision was...
that I'll just fix it later.
Exactly. So you got 10 women doing some things and you were going to come along and fix up the work of 10 women rather than confront the issue. Right?
Yep.
That's your fear of confronting the woman and her potential to anger, right?
Yep.
All present there. And then, of course, they are there thinking, oh, well, no, Lincoln's given us the feeling. He's letting us be dominant over him. That's the feeling they want. You're letting them dominate you. And that's exactly what they want. They don't need to hear you anymore. They're just there in your company, there with a man that they can dominate. That's what they wanted. Does that make sense?
Yep.
Yep. Now, a lot of you ladies might think that's fairly harsh, but that's what was going on right there in that little situation, right? Now, some of you ladies, after it was pointed out, recognised it within yourself that that was present. But you were also afraid of addressing it with the other ladies who did not see it. And that's your fear of women that are angry. Right? So you get this situation being created then in the end where somebody's giving instructions. So Lincoln, the man, is giving instructions. The women are there because he's a man that can be dominated. That's the only reason why they're there. If he was not a man that can be dominated, they wouldn't feel as attracted to be there because that's the addiction. Right? And then when he says, oh, but I want it this way, they know they can ignore him and do it their own way. And Lincoln was perfectly okay with that, and he was willing to go along afterwards and spend 4 hours of his own time fixing up what they'd done. But unfortunately, it also stopped us from doing further things that would have been practical. Because if we had all of that newspaper already down in the right way, we could just come along, throw extra newspaper as we finished up doing, and getting a lot of the stuff covered that was uncovered without even planning it. And we got a lot more work done straight after that, if you remember. Yep. And so that's another indication of the same issue. The fact is that every time you don't confront these issues within you, everything slows down. Everything sort of falls to pieces. And that is pretty normal. Alan?
I had an interesting experience around assuming that the women would know what they're doing. I came into it a bit late.
Can I point out to you, though, that is because you are women dominant? You do allow women to dominate you.
Yeah, exactly. And I assume that was okay because that's the emotion, the addiction that's going on. Yeah.
Well, no, you also not only assume it's okay, you've been taught from a very young age that that's the way a good man is.
Yeah.
A good man always will let his woman do what she wants.
Sure, yes.
But what if she's illogical?
Yeah, and that's what I wanted to share. It was the day before, I was talking to Lincoln mostly and he was really well and directing me. And it was a lot of things were logical. And it was also an experiment. So I came up there pretty tired from the reptile park. Oh, I shouldn't say that, but yeah, that place.
Be honest.
Yeah. And
the reptile park, we're going to call it that. Yeah. What is the proper term? Reptile heaven is what it is.
Okay.
Michael's words, reptile heaven.
Yeah, and... So I just asked the women when I got there, what are we doing and what's the pathway for and how is it structured and that. And they explained it pretty well,
yep.
But I didn't even think about all the edges, you know, just went straight into...
And what you're a man. You should have been the first person that thought about the edges.
Well, I used to teach this stuff years ago.
Exactly. So what's going on?
Still working on that. Yeah, okay.
Can you see that your logic deserts you when you're trying to favour the feminine?
Yeah, I was definitely favouring the feminine.
So in other words, you're denying a masculine characteristic in order to favour the feminine. Now, if you were truly in balance, you would never deny a characteristic God gave you.
Yeah. True. Yeah.
Right. In order to favour something else.
Yeah.
Does that make sense?
Yeah.
So this is where we need to see what's going on, because it's really wonderful to see it.
Yes.
And to use it as a way of working our way through these particular.
And when
issues.
You turned up and you said, "I just want to address this," and you went through the motions of it all, it just sounded so logical. I was standing there going, "Where am I? Am I out of am I out of my body or something?"
Yeah. No, where you are is in favour of the woman.
Yeah.
So if the woman wants to make things pretty before it's functional, you'll go along with that.
Yeah.
Right. And what God does is make things functional and then pretty.
I feel there's still guilt there with my mother, and I'm favouring the woman.
Yeah. There's a lot of issues involved in it, obviously, for both the women and the men, right?
Yeah.
So it's not just a female issue, it's both issues. In our case, many of the men in the audience are allowing their women to be very illogical most of the time, and then supporting that because they feel that's what a good man does.
Yeah.
And many of the women believe that's also what a good man does. And so if you did something different, they'd be angry with you.
Yeah, that's it.
Does that make sense? Yeah. So this is an issue that we need to address. If we're going to actually build systems that are complete, they'll be balanced both with masculinity and femininity. They'll be balanced. They won't have a dominant masculine side. Remember the problem with the ponds? Dominant masculine side caused by attitude of a few people building them. And what did we have to do? Two whole days of manual labour, plus getting in a $400 piece of equipment as well, plus Peter's tractor breaking down, and quite a number of other things to fix it. Does that make sense? Mm. All of that wouldn't have happened if it was nice and even with masculinity and femininity. So none of that would have happened if it wasn't for those particular emotions being honoured or not being addressed by someone else. Yep. So if I looked at the path and I went, yeah, this is getting pretty illogical, it's looking pretty illogical to me, and instead of doing anything, I just said, let it happen, no one would have learnt anything today about that, how illogical it was. Does that make sense? In addition, I wouldn't have been able to have this conversation with you about it. And in addition to that, we would have ended up with a garden that was flawed as well. So all this work being done, and an outcome that's not as perfect as it could be because of the flaw, which is the flaw emotionally within ourselves. Yep, Alex?
Can I ask you, AJ, how does it look in a perfected man, the logic versus emotion?
Well, a perfected man or woman honours both the function and the form. They honour both the structure and the beauty. Now, a man who's not as perfected in this way will honour either the structure over the beauty, or he will go along with the feminine and honour the beauty over the structure. And the same applies to the woman. A woman who's perfected will honour the structure and the beauty. A woman who's not perfected will honour either the beauty over the structure, if she's woman dominant or female dominant, or if she's masculine dominant, she'll wait for the man to do all the structure and try to get it all logical before she'll engage the beauty. Right? So either way, there's a problem. Each of us should have a good balance. We should, if we are completely open to both genders, without any addiction, sexual or otherwise, then we would not honour one gender over the other. If we wouldn't honour one gender over the other, it means that every gender, all genders, of which there are only two, by the way, it's not a hard thing. Right? It's not like there's 100 genders and you've got to balance it all. There's only two, right? You think that should be pretty simple. But what we would do is we'd balance it, right? They'd be balanced and we'd have the same attitude towards men and women. So in fact, when you're even dealing with a woman, you would have exactly the same feelings towards her as you would the man. So do you think you'd have any sexual projection in that place? Definitely not, right? And because you're honouring both parts of the gender, both genders equally. When you honour both genders equally, there is not a dominance of one side or the other, and there's no addiction involved. Yeah? And it's very easy to see the more refined you become with it. It's very easy to see the imbalance as to what happens. Yeah. Yep.
So if you're a woman who has tried to value logic and function, is that because I have a sexual need for the man's approval that I've... Because I don't feel like I've connected with a lot of the beauty stuff.
Yes, this is something that myself and Mary were discussing as well. If you are a woman who is seeking to be logical, you're trying to be practical and logical, then there's a difference between trying and actually doing it, of course, right? If you're seeking or trying to be logical, then yes, you have a desire to get the man's approval by becoming like the man in some way. Now, many of the men have the same desire to become like a woman in some way so that they get the woman's approval. Should we need to do that? Not at all. We need to be ourselves, and whoever loves us for ourselves. Does that make sense? We shouldn't be having to seek to do something the other gender wants in order just to get the approval. Yeah. Whether that other gender is a male or a female makes no difference. You see, if you're balanced, you won't have a preference for a female's company or a male's company. You might have a preference for individuals' company because they're either nice or not nice, right? They're either loving or not loving, but you won't have a preference for a women's company over a men or men's company over women, right? All of these things are what creates the imbalance, and when you're working together, you really see the imbalance. That's when it all comes out, you know, in the actual operation. That's when the structure that you're creating falls down, or the beauty that you're creating falls down. One or both will fall down because of the imbalance. Teresa?
What about for the women like myself who are more logical and structured? Is that an injury, or is it... what is it?
Well, most of the time, like, we all have logic and structure, and we all have the capacity for beauty as well, right? What I'm saying is when we see one side falling down over the other, then we know we have some kind of addiction in play. So if you find that the beauty side of your life, in terms of creativity, is falling down in favour of the logic, now it indicates there's an issue with the femininity. Does that make sense? Yep. And it's the same with the guy. So exactly the same with the guy. If the beauty side of what the guy does is falling down in favour of the logic, then he's got a block towards the feminine. It doesn't... Well, we're not talking about here about feminine traits inside the person. We're talking about the traits that they're projecting to the world. See, a lot of people say to me things like, every one of us should have a balance inside of us of femininity and masculinity. Well, to be blunt with you, that's a load of crap, really. Right? The reality is men are going to be more masculine, generally, and women are going to be more feminine, generally. Why? Because the feminine side of the soul attracts the feminine body. You know, of course you're going to be more feminine, and the masculine side of the soul attracts a masculine body. So we're not talking here about what's inside. What we're talking about is the belief and emotions towards the outside. So what's outside of you? So when there's an imbalance towards what's outside of you, now we've got the issue. So a person can be a very masculine person, but have a balance towards what's outside of him. Do you understand what I'm saying there? So you can be a masculine man and have a balance towards what's outside of you. In other words, you treat women and men exactly the same way. You won't have a feeling that logic is more important than beauty. Does that make sense to everyone? That doesn't mean that you're more feminine. The fact that you've attracted a masculine body means you're more masculine than feminine. Do you follow me? But we've got to honour at what's outside of us and the particular things, the particular qualities that are involved in masculinity and femininity that others display. And if we have no blockages towards either the masculine or the feminine, then we'll be very balanced in the way in which we be ourselves. Yep. So many of you ladies will find that you spent a lot of your life trying to get men's approval, right? And a lot of times you don't even hear him. You don't even hear the man. All you're interested in is getting the feeling of approval from him. Does that make sense? It doesn't matter if what he says. He can go blah, 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 and as long as he's got a feeling coming from him that he likes you, you'll be happy. You won't even be confused. But if he hasn't got that feeling coming out of him and he says something very logical, you go, I don't understand. You'll be totally confused. This is the interesting thing about masculinity and femininity, right? Ooh. What was that? I'm gone. Yeah, I am. No? Oh, no. Is that because of the lightning? Oh, okay. No. Had a logical situation. Oh, that was the equalizer coming in. Yes. Sorry? Yeah, the wind's hitting my mic. I'm just wondering if I just get a bit of a wind cap for it, if there's one available. Speak away. There you go. No wind. No wind. Okay. And so what we need to understand is with what we're discussing is that women are going to be more feminine than men. That's a given. You've attracted a female's body. Of course you're going to be more feminine than a man. That is because you have more of the feminine qualities of the soul than the other half of you has. That makes sense, doesn't it? And even if you're a lesbian couple, you that means your whole soul is even more feminine than the majority of souls. That's what that means, right? The fact that you've attracted a female body is a total indication that you are more feminine than a man. Simple as that. But how you interact with men, would still honour the masculine qualities. The masculine qualities of logic, function, structure, things like that. Right? Now, if a man did the same thing, he would still be masculine. He'd honour logic, function, structure, and all those kind of things. But he will also honour beauty. He'll honour tidiness, cleanliness, and all those other things. Does that make sense? If he was not blocked towards the female. So a man wouldn't go around leaving his socks all over the floor everywhere if he honoured the feminine properly. You see, what many of us do is we're not honouring the other gender at all. We are only looking for addictions met in the other gender. So we're not honouring them. We're just happy with the people that give us what we want. We're in a barter system. And like I said, it doesn't matter what language they speak, right? Or speak no language at all. As long as you feel the feeling coming from the person, you're either happy or unhappy. And that is an indication too that the addiction is involved. So in future... if you ever want to come to a future one. in future, what we'd like to do is see more balance between the genders, yeah? And like I said, there's only two. It's not like it's hard. It's just a matter of honouring the other gender, but also honouring your own to an equal degree, yeah? So for example, if somebody's saying, oh, doesn't matter what it looks like, just get it done. What's that? That's a male dominance. You can feel it in the person, right? A person who honours it externally would go, it does matter the function, that the function does matter, but you also want it to look good, right? That's what will happen when we're balanced. We want it to look good as well as have function. Yeah, Philip? Now I'm eating it. Tastes all right, yeah. It's all right, next mic. Far away.
Is it on? Yes. What was the question? So with what you were just saying then...
Does it make any logical sense, does it? No, keep going. Now she's forgotten what she wants to say.
So when a guy says, you know, or you ask questions about something and you don't understand it as a woman,
mm-hmm.
and the guy goes, you know, whatever, well, you know, we just need to get it done, so just get it done, doesn't matter what it looks like.
Yeah.
That's
way out of line.
And that's then the feeling... for me,
yeah.
is because I'm not understanding it. Mary and I were talking about this today as well.
Yeah.
Like, I feel really stupid
yeah.
because I'm not understanding it, and I feel like, you know...
And his purpose is to make you feel stupid, actually.
Yeah.
This kind of situation I had with an interaction between myself and Eloisa today. We were working on the pond down at the reptile heaven. Right? And the bottom pond, we were determining the levels, and we were using the levelling system. And Eloisa didn't understand how the levelling system was working. So she asked a number of questions, which is fantastic, right? And if I had said to her, Eloisa, just read out the numbers. Can we just get going and read out the numbers? What is that saying? I am understanding. It doesn't matter to me if she doesn't. Now, if that's the case, I'm being male dominant. And many men do this, right, when they're interacting with women. Now, what I would want to do is share it with her, what's going on, and explain it in a simple way. Take the time to do so. So what I did was explain. Imagine that if I've got a line here, and if I move this down, you know, what happens? And if I move this up, what happens? And eventually, Eloise would go, oh, yeah, I get that, right? Because it was explained simply to her. And so she can get that then. And then we could proceed doing what we're doing with her understanding what was going on. Does that make sense? Now, if a man's saying to the woman, look, you don't have to understand, I know what's going on, just go and do it. Now, that's a very unkind thing to do for a start, but it's also not honouring the fact, it's actually helping the woman stay in an ignorant fact towards the masculine. You're actually, like, if you're a guy doing that to a girl, you're actually making your life worse. Because in the end, she'll understand less about a man after she's finished with that than she would have been if you'd done something different. That makes sense.
So it also probably means as well that the job wouldn't be done the way the man wanted to do it, because the woman would perhaps be
would already be working against.
Feeling, yeah.
Of course, she's already got an emotion. I don't want to be here. Why do I want to be here? I've just been treated badly. Up him. I'm gonna, you know, when we read out the numbers, I'll say it's 105 when it's 107. And he can deal with that later. Many women go, well, men go that way, don't they? Both men and women go that way when they feel that feeling that they've been dismissed and treated badly and ignored. Often they get into rebellion then, right? And yet all it requires is a bit of love given to the person and take some time out, you know, take some time to address the issues. And if somebody doesn't understand, it's because there is a block to it. So if Eloise is not understanding what it is right at the beginning, there is a block towards the logic that's there. But you wouldn't then go, now you're just blocked towards a man. What's going on? You know, would you? Like, that's not loving either. You would help her go through the process of firstly understanding and then also helping her understand why she feels blocked. And when she feels about it, she feels... Oh, yeah, my father's controlled me most of my life, right? Of course I'm going to be blocked towards listening to the male's logic, because my dad's been trying to control me all my life, and I want to get away from that, you know? I don't want that control. And actually, Eloisa, in this interaction with me today, felt some of that even. That's the beauty of addressing the issue with love and kindness in the process at the time, yeah? Some of you ladies today, when we were up there and we were dealing with the paper issue, you could feel your demand to have everything beautiful before it's even finished. Right? That feeling in you that you want everything looking good while it's happening, instead of just working on the structure first and then putting the beauty into it afterwards, right? Which is the more logical way of approaching the situation. So we're not dismissing the beauty. We're adding the beauty once the function has been proven. Yeah, that's what the logical thing to do would be. So this is the beautiful thing about these kind of situations, is that they help expose a group of emotions, and then you can address these particular emotions. So we stopped everybody, didn't we, Eloisa? Myself and Eloisa, she had one end of the stick, I had the other. Everyone was standing around just waiting for us to finish the level. And if it meant that we were standing around for 10 minutes while I explained to Eloisa how it worked, I was happy with that. Everyone else was learning something in the process generally. Most of the people there had never used a level before, so everyone was learning. And we finished up getting it nice and level. We know where the levels are and everything. And it's perfect. Yeah, because you filled it up today. It's full of water now, yeah. And it's flowing properly. And out the bottom, yeah, exactly as we planned. Yeah. Whereas if we... So if I just said, just read out the numbers, like Eloisa instantly feels bad about herself, she feels worse about herself, she doesn't understand, she now feels confused. There's a higher likelihood of her going outside of her body in that place. There's a higher likelihood of her then even doing something that's, you know, a mistake of some kind because she's not connected with herself and not connected with the task. Does that make sense? So while we took 10 minutes, if we'd done it the other way, they might be emptying the water right now. Do you know what I mean? To fix it all up. And that's the issue. You see, that's what we would have faced over there with the dams, with the ponds. You know, if we'd just gone ahead without doing these levels. So I look at it and I go, man, these are out of level. We've got to double check all of this, right? And it's going to take us some time. And people sort of go, oh, but I don't know about the time. It's wasting everybody's time. No, it's not. What's a waste of everyone's time is building a pond completely only to have it breach the very first time that it rains and overflows the pond. That's a waste of time. Doing an extra day getting it all level is not a waste of time. Right? That's the thing we need to look at. So what I'd like to encourage you to do in your day-to-day life is to look at when you put down these masculine and feminine characteristics in your day-to-day life, when you get frustrated with the other gender for what they're doing. And then ask yourself, is what they're doing logical or, you know, ending up beautiful? Is that why I'm getting frustrated? Quite often, you'll find that the frustration results from the conflict between these two parts or two sides of getting something done. Just remember that God does everything with function and beauty, with structure and beauty, everything. That's because God is perfectly balanced with masculinity and femininity. Perfectly balanced. Yeah. Right at the back, it says... Almost needing to do some singing, me and Fab, I think.
I just wanted to say that I feel incredibly blessed because the team that I was in had both the leader and, in my experience, was the leader and the three assistants were all just the most beautiful men in terms of understanding the need to explain. And with love, with so much love,
yeah,
that I could really feel so much healing about having been treated as being stupid because I was so not being treated like I was stupid.
Yeah.
It just brought up so much grief for me. And it was, yeah. It's been just the most beautiful day after day after day. They didn't even, you know, stop doing that after the first day.
Yeah.
And
so it's not like they had a tolerant level.
No. And there was beauty. That's why I was really thrilled because there was such a beauty as well in what we were doing.
Yeah.
It was so such a fine sort of vibration and I've had a really wonderful time.
Yeah, that's good. Because and this is what we often find is if you have a person, it can be a male or a female, who is balanced in the way they apply these principles, they will still, their masculinity or femininity will shine, but they won't be blocked towards the feminine or towards the masculine in either way. So in other words, any woman or man who's working with them is going to feel like they're honoured rather than disrespected. Trust me, if most of you ladies worked with two of Peter's workers, you would constantly feel disrespected. Most of you would be livid angry within a few minutes probably with those particular men, right? Given your current set of emotional injuries of intolerance towards the male, you'd definitely be livid angry with them. Now, many of the men would also find it difficult working with those men because many of you men have a preference towards the female and you would find it also quite difficult working with those guys as well. See, the problem is whenever we have this imbalance, every gender is going to have trouble working with us. That's why you find some people are not very good to work with. Some people are pretty hard to tolerate when they're working with you. Right? And that's one of the reasons why, because there's not this beautiful balance that goes on that's coming out of them. And it's their attitude coming out of them, their belief system coming out of them towards both genders, towards both the male and the female. So I wanted to raise some of that with you. Myself and Mary want to do quite a lot of chats with you at some point in the future about masculinity and femininity, don't we, darling? But because, it's something that's really important to understand, this honouring of the other gender's natural innate abilities, right? See, many men do not honour the woman's natural abilities that are inbuilt in as a part of feminine characteristics. And many women do not honour men's natural abilities either. And as a result, that causes a separation between each gender, towards men and women. And of course, if there's separation towards men and women, you're going to have a separation in your relationship. You're going to have a separation when you're working as a team. You're going to have separation when you go out and have some fun. This is why on Earth here, almost everything that's done with men and women is done with groups of women and groups of men, but not together. Right? In the celestial kingdom, what do you reckon it's like?
Together.
Very balanced. Everything's balanced. Yeah.
Just looking at the men who are listening to you and open to you, it seems to me like there aren't very many of Peter's workers type of men who are listening. So what's the significance of that?
Well, that's because they can feel that I am just as open to a woman as I am to the man, right? And therefore, they don't like that. That's automatically confronting. So many men in the state where they find that confronting just turn off. It's just like, I can ignore that, I can ignore that, I can ignore that. Right? And if you speak with Peter's workers, that's exactly what they're like. Like, Eloisa and Susan have a lot of difficulty with these two workers trying to give them directions. And in fact, they don't even bother, do you? Don't even bother. Because they know that it's like they're totally deaf, dumb and blind to what they're saying, you know? Yeah. Whereas a man who's a bit more open to both will find it a bit more easier. What do you want to say, babe? I can hear you screaming out there. You want a mic? Not really.
I was just mentioning that there is a mixture of men who listen to the divine truth.
Yes, there is. There is a balance of men.
Some men who are very male dominant.
And arrogant. And there's other men who are very female dominant.
Yeah,
I agree. And a lot of that is because I will tolerate both. I can work with both. Does that make sense? But if I was more feminine dominant, I'd only attract just one group of males. Yeah. And that'd only be feminine dominant males. Yep. Yep. Just straight in front. Keep your hand up, Ken.
I have a question then. If, like, asking my partner or another woman for her feeling or her opinion,
mm-hmm.
respecting her feelings, if you're working on your own project, so to speak, but feeling it yourself and respecting the other person, is that a balance, if you know what I mean?
Ken, you've got to learn to ask specific questions.
Oh.
So you've got a situation in your mind that you don't want to relate.
Yeah, that's true.
Yeah, because you're worried about offending your wife.
Well, true.
Okay.
True. Yeah.
So So can you see already we've got a problem? Like, you're talking in riddles and I'm meant to give you an answer. Does that make sense?
Yeah, yeah.
See, if you weren't as worried about offending your wife, you'd say, the other day, what happened between me and her was this. Yeah, yeah. And then I'd be able to give
a much more direct, straightforward answer. Does that make sense? I'm not going to do that now because you are still worried about offending me, so I can't do that. But this is what we need to learn. We need to learn that, you see, we are so sensitive, particularly when we're in a partnership, right? We are so sensitive, we know the other person doesn't like me talking about it. So what I've got to do, if I'm asking AJ a question, I've got to sort of make it around about and out there and make it very, very loose so that it's sort of not very, you know, it's not about us, in other words. Well, it's all about you, of course it is, right? It's all about you. So let it be about you. Be open and honest and let it be about you. And if your wife's offended, she's offended. And you can talk to her about that. Well, how logical is it to be offended, darling? Like, I'm just trying to help our relationship. You know, it's not logical to be offended about discussing something in our relationship. And if you're offended, why are you offended? Oh, it's because I felt humiliated, or I felt, you know, feel the feeling, but still get the truth out. Many of you have gotten used to asking me questions that are not direct. You know, say, oh, the other day this happened to me, because you're worried about who else might hear it, whether mum, dad, sister, brother, uncle, auntie, or, you know, and also friends, family, workmen, whatever, all the people who were involved in the situation might hear you. And so what you do instead is you come up with all of these ways of manipulating, or we could say ways of controlling the feelings of others before they've even had them. That's what you come up with. So you come up with these methods of circumventing that person's feeling, going around that person's feeling, going forward for that person's feeling, going around that person's feeling, and then in the end you expect me to interpret all of that and give you an answer that's logical. Oh God, yeah. Sure, I can feel about what you're feeling about. And it's fortunate that I can, because if I couldn't, I'd be totally confused. but we also must learn to speak the truth. And we've got to learn to speak the truth without any embarrassment. And without any embarrassment for our partner, our friends or whatever, just speak it as it is, because when it's spoken as it is, everything can be sorted out.
Say how you really feel.
Say how you really feel, and say the situation as it really is. It can all be sorted out then, you see. That's the beauty of truth. Now that's a quality that should be inherent in both genders, this love for truth. That's not a dominant male or a dominant female characteristic. That is something that we all need to develop, this honour of the truth. Honestly, it makes your life a lot more simple, right? Because you're not sitting down asking a question for a half an hour that you could have asked in 1 minute. So that's simple. That's not wasting time. That's obviously the most logical thing to do. So learn to be specific. Learn to say what it's about. Learn to be open about what it's about, even if you're potentially going to offend your partner in the process. Because all you're doing is being in fear about this process, right? Now, it doesn't mean blaming her, and I know you don't have that feeling in you, Ken. Like, you don't have the feeling of wanting to blame the woman all the time. And so just ask the question, get an answer, and even if it offends her, okay, it offends her. She needs to feel that, you know, needs to feel about that. Yeah. Pleasure.
Thank you.
Pleasure.
I'm going to put this in action.
Okay.
So, AJ, can you tell us what's going on in our relationship? Because I get so frustrated that Kerry doesn't see the logic in things.
Right.
Like, it can be as simple as us packing the van and the car.
Yep.
And we'll have massive arguments about it, where Kerry gets to the point of, well, I'm just not even going to try because, you know, I can't do the whole Tetris thing.
Yeah.
So many occasions.
So is that what you call it, Kerry, the Tetris thing?
Yeah, that's what we call it.
Awesome, That's a lot of passive aggression there. That's really good. Don't be embarrassed.
But this is something that we've noticed a lot within our relationship.
Sure.
In that I seem to see the logic.
One half of the soul will also see the logic, will generally see the logic better than the other half. Remember that it's about the honouring of the other half. However, and we've had a lot of this going on with us over 5 years, you know, where we've had a lot of issues to work through with logic and function and form and beauty and things like that. And what we find is that most of the time, the person with the blockage towards the logic or the blockage towards the beauty has an issue with that characteristic parent. So in other words, there's a large... So, Kerry, I would suggest to you that you've got some issues with Dad that prevent you from even desiring to be logical. Does that make sense? And the issues with Dad are preventing an openness to the logic. And if you think about how you feel about Dad, you can feel that, yeah, I'm still fairly angry with him, I'd like to rebel against him and so forth because of, you know, what he's done. And this feeling of rebellion causes a rebellion against any masculine characteristic. Does that make sense? Yep. And this is a natural thing to occur. Whenever we have some kind of childhood issue towards the parent that has that characteristic, we will then even rebel completely. We will not even want to engage the development of that characteristic. Yeah. So we even harm our own self, and we harm the unification of the soul just because we don't want to feel the emotion towards the person who had that dominant characteristic in our childhood. Yeah. So that would be the thing to work through. Does that make sense? So you obviously don't have that same feeling, Paige. So,
well, I thought it may have been that I was being overly dominant with the masculine because I was, as you mentioned before, wanting approval from my dad.
Yeah, different dynamic with your dad. With Kerry, there was a lot more harsh treatment with father than with you, right? So Kerry's got a lot more feelings of rebellion against father, whereas you've got a lot more feelings towards pleasing father. Yeah. However, a person who is completely logical is fine. That's great. It's good to be logical. Okay. It's not about... It's when you choose logic over beauty, now you're imbalanced. Yeah. So you're not doing that.
No.
So that tells you that it's balanced. Does that make sense?
Okay.
Yeah. And the key is to understand where our partner is coming from, you know, in terms of their own damage. But also, we need to discuss with our partner and be firm on the issue. Although, if we have a logical issue, there's an issue that comes up regularly, then there's got to be something going on towards Dad, generally in our childhood, or Mum's beliefs about that in the childhood that we've accepted, that we then causes us to be blocked towards that aspect of our soul. Remember, if you're, it doesn't matter whether you're what kind of soul you are, whether you're a homosexual soul or a heterosexual soul, you're one soul. There's two people, one soul in two bodies. Make sense? Now, if there's one soul in two bodies, every time you deny a characteristic of the soul, your own complete soul, you're really separating the two halves. You're pushing away from each other. Does that make sense to everyone? You're actually causing a fracture in your own soul towards the other half when you have an attitude towards the other half, whatever the attitude is. You're causing a fracture in the development of your soul. If you can stop fracturing your soul and draw your soul back together again, now you've got the capacity of building your soul. It's like what happens and what we notice a lot happening on Earth is you see these the two halves of the soul really working against each other a lot of times. Now, an interesting fact is that if you've got two people pulling against each other, what's the net effect? It is separation, but what's the net effect to the, in the middle? Nothing moves, does it? And the strongest one will determine the direction. So the person who's the most forceful will determine the direction, but it's not going to be a very pleasant life, is it? There's going to be separation, and the person who's pulling the strongest. So if we've got something, just let's illustrate this. Okay, yeah, we don't mind tearing up my jumper. I've had this jumper for I don't know how long, right? Now, if I'm pulling and Mary's pulling the opposite direction, if that's our relationship, Now, it really is going to depend on what issue we're pulling on as to who's going to win. Isn't it? But all this time, we're not going anywhere. We're pulling on the jumper exactly the same amount of force at the moment, and we're not going anywhere. Our relationship's not going anywhere, and yet we're putting all this effort in the relationship, and it's not going anywhere because we're both pulling in the opposite direction, and it just on and whatever the matter is, it just depends on whether I pull harder or Mary pulls harder, right? And or the relationship breaks. That's what's going to happen. Now you imagine if instead of doing that, here's the jumper, and we both come together and we walk along with it. How relaxed is that? There's no effort. There's no opposite effort pulling in opposite directions. We're working together. The relationship is staying intact without any stress or strain. You see? And it's relaxed and happy relationship. And it's not torn apart. Right? And everything stays together. And imagine if we're coming closer and closer together as we're doing it. Now there's the double... It's not just that we have double the force anymore, because before we were having the same... We were having force when we were pulling. We're having force. But because it's in completely opposite directions, we're going nowhere. And that's where all of our energy is going. All of our energy is going and going nowhere. And so, of course, we're going to feel tired, exhausted, strained, right? All those things are going to be there. Now, once we start coming together, the relationship relaxes, we relax, right? We're also now working together. If we're working together towards a common goal, there's a high likelihood now, particularly if we work together together, that we can put much larger force into something that one person could not do alone. And in fact, the soul has the characteristic where because they're together, the soul itself is now stronger. So it's actually stronger than its two halves, right? And therefore has the ability to create in a much larger way. It can create more than I could create individually without Mary. Or what Mary could create, if you grab the mic, if what Mary could create without me.
And it's actually more than the sum of those two separate things.
Also. So it's like, it's not 1 + 1 = 2 with regard to the soul
working together. Or the
creativity of it. Because now the soul is binding together. It has all this internal strength that it didn't have separately, and it certainly won't have if it's pulling itself apart. Right? So it's like there's more ability of this soul working together than is ever possible working individually or separately or against each other. And most of us are not realising that, because what we're doing is we're basically pulling on different issues. And why are we doing that? Why do we have this thing going on with different issues? Because one or both of us do not want to face a certain emotion. We don't want to face a certain emotional false belief that we have. That's the only reason why we do that. One or both of us. Now, one of us might be right. So Mary might say something to me and she might be right and I just might resist it. Or I might say something to Mary and I might be right and she's just resisting me. But if we have the ability to work our way through that as rapidly as possible, then instead of pulling, we're working together. We can actually, if you think about it, if we have the right attitude, we can actually help each other move forward. This is what we'd do if masculinity and femininity was balanced. We'd be helping each other move forward. One of us wouldn't be going, you're humiliating me now just because you're telling me the truth. Or you're making me feel small. You know, I don't like this, you know, I want to leave because of this or whatever.
So in the example of the Tetris thing,
yep.
Me always packing the car is not going to help Kerry deal
and
start to challenge those issues with her dad.
That's correct. So what we've done is we've sat down together and I've explained the logic of packing the vehicle. And Mary's then had to look at the logic and go, well, why do I get all that? So if I get all that, why aren't I doing that? There's got to be some blockage towards the masculine that causes me to rebel against that. Does that make sense?
Yeah.
Yeah. And so Mary looks at that. And it's the same with me, with the house, cleaning up, whatever, you know, doing the dishes or all, you know, or even creative things that Mary does, you know, that I could be looking at. So we need to look at those things together. Pass across Graham, then on this side, come across to Jen. Might be appropriate. Fire away, Graham.
Okay. Well, I'm one of these guys that are female dominated.
Yeah, you are.
And
your logic often goes out the window when you're in the company of women.
Yeah. And I have the trouble that... And Jen's one of the ones that likes to dominate a guy.
Yes, I agree.
And when I try and point out something like that, you know, I get subject to accusations and stuff.
Of course, you're now angry, annoyed, you must be, you know...
And I'm judgmental.
Judgmental or whatever, yes.
Yeah. And the really difficult for me thing for me is that I then get accused of being controlling when it's like... like, for example, this afternoon, Jen saw me feeding a woman's addiction. And she got quite triggered by that.
Of course.
And but
because you're actually giving, in a way, almost sexually to the woman, aren't you?
Yes. And she then tried to get me to change in some way or other.
Yep.
To make me realise something, or to make me feel something, or to make me experience something.
Yep.
But then when I pointed out that I was only doing with that woman exactly what I do with her...
Yeah, which is true. Which is true.
Well, then it got worse.
Of course. But it's true. It's true. You are... But what Jen wants is you doing that with her, but not with another woman. Which is actually an inequality. Right? Isn't it?
Yes.
So the reality is that... once you fix this issue, Jen will feel quite triggered about the issue of control, because she will no longer have control over Graham. And the reality is, in a relationship, each part does not need control over the other half. You don't need control. What you want between you is love. Love should be the binding thing, not control. If control is the binding thing, then the relationship's out of kilter before you begin. Love needs to be the binding thing. Now, love would give to the other, desire the other. Desire is different to manipulation and control. So what we would like to do is desire the other. Now, what Jen's worried about is that she can't, when you are sharing this part of your energy with another woman, right, which is just feeding one of your own addictions and hers, you are now not desiring only Jen. And that's where she gets offended. Does that make sense? But you are right, too, in that Jen wants you to feed her addictions. So this is where it's out of balance. So you can address this quite specifically by addressing the addiction within yourself to get the addiction met with women, no matter what the woman is. So that's how you address it within yourself. And then once you've addressed that, you can then be firm. I'm not giving this feeling to anyone else, but I'm certainly also not giving it to you.
Can you explain that?
If it's an addiction... Yeah.
I didn't quite follow.
Yeah, so let's sort of explain that in more detail. Let's say Jen wants you to make her feel like she's a good woman. And you know that if you make Jen feel like she's a good woman, then you'll get a lot of good treatment as a result. Right? So you won't get attacked, and you won't get dismissed, and you'll be approved of all the time. So if you engage that, you're actually feeding your own addiction to feel like you're a good fellow. That makes sense? And in the process of feeding her addiction, you get your own addiction back.
So I'm addicted to feeling like I'm a good fellow?
Yeah, a woman thinking that you are.
Okay.
It doesn't matter to you if a man thinks you are or not, right? But it matters to you if a woman thinks you are or not. And you know in your relationship with Jen, if you make her feel certain things, that she'll give that feeling back to you. Well, that's a codependent addictive relationship. Once you no longer feed that addiction, you will actually be more honouring of your soul, of your complete soul. So once you no longer feed your own addiction to have the approval of the woman, in other words, you're willing to go through your own grief that you never had your mother's approval, right? Because that's the main issue, not getting mum's approval. Once you're willing to feel through that grief, you'll be able to actually be a man when a woman's around. Now, if that woman wants you to pander to her, you wouldn't be able to do it. Whether you love her or not, you still won't be able to do it. So even if you love her, you won't be able to pander to her under those circumstances. And you certainly wouldn't pander to one that you don't love if you didn't pander to one that you do.
So I need to deal with the fear of a woman not liking me.
Yes, and...
my mum not liking me.
Mother, yes. Remember, this all goes back to childhood, these childhood addictions. There's the childhood addictions generally with the same and opposite gender parents that cause these blockages between ourselves and the other half of our soul. And this is what I'm saying, in a practical environment like we've been in today, you can see it in play, and if we confront it in the practical environment, it can help expose what's going on. And it's wonderful. And this is what you want. Does that make sense? That's how you want it to be. You want it to be confronted in these practical environments, because then you'll be able to change it. You'll be able to go, okay. So with the interaction between Eloisa and myself today with our water levels, Eloisa said, she said, why am I so black? And I said, feel about your dad. That's all you've got to do. You know, when Eloisa started feeling about dad, she started crying. Dad just wants to control me all the time, and that's how dad is, isn't he? He just wants to control you all the time. No wonder you don't want to be logical, because that's a trait of dad, and who wants dad controlling me all the time? So there's a rejection of the masculine in that place, and that causes a shutdown of the absorption of logic, the shutdown of the absorption of mathematics, which are generally more masculine traits. We shut them all down. The woman is just as capable of understanding mathematics and logic as a man is, but not if she's shut down towards the male. A man is just as capable of understanding beauty and comfort and love and other considerations such as that, which are all a lot of feminine traits and qualities, as a woman is, but not if he's shut down towards the woman. Yep. Tim was next. If we can come down there, Louise.
When you walk side by side with Mary, I've experienced that then our guides can come along with us and assist us with the side by side when we get to that point. And when you're pulling.
Be more specific, Jen, I'm confused.
When you were illustrating
the pulling. Yep.
And you illustrated the side-by-side motion where you both come together.
Yep.
I have the feeling that your guides and Mary guides are there as well, and God's in that interaction assisting for the process to move forward.
Yes, but the reality is our guides don't even need to be there in those moments, because we are working together and we're very connected with God and ourselves. Our guides are just there to have a chat with at the end of the day, right? And those... when we're working apart, our guys are going in and you're working apart again, what's going on, face this issue instead of fighting on the issue. That's when our guys have to do more work. Our guys have to have to do any work whatsoever when we're together and we're wanting to be together and we're wanting to work through the issues together. So it's beautiful now in our relationship, because we can just openly and honestly talk about any subject whatsoever without one or the other getting in an uproar about the situation, right? We can talk openly and honestly about any situation whatsoever that may confront one or both of us without us feeling like it's the end of the world or the end of our relationship or just lots and lots of difficulties in that place. Does that make sense?
It does make sense.
Yep.
The thing that I find very difficult in my relationship with Graham is I sense what it should be like, but I feel blind.
Yeah, see, I can't agree with that, Jen. You are totally incapable presently of sensing what it should be like. Your guides are telling you what it should be like. which is very different than you sensing what it should be like. Given your emotional injuries, it's impossible for you at the moment to have an accurate sense of what your relationship should be like. It can only come from your guides at the moment. And because you are pretty open to spirits, they can pretty much give you a fairly good picture of that. You follow me? But for you to really, for yourself, to sense what it should be like, you'll have to work through your blockages with the male. That's the only way you're going to be able to do it. And for Graham to sense what it should be like, he's going to have to work through his blockages with the female. That's what he's going to have to do to sense. And in fact, we both genders have to work through our blockages with both genders to truly sense what the relationship should be like for ourselves. Until that point in time, we're just getting some guidance from our spirit friends who are trying to help us have a concept of what it should be like.
It's a fairly blind place, I
feel. Where you are now, you mean?
I feel blind. I'm kind of...
Yes, you will be blind while you're in total denial of the emotions towards the opposite gender or towards the same gender. This is the importance of dealing with these emotions. You cannot have clarity until the emotion is released. Many of you still don't really get that. That clarity cannot come before the emotion is released. Before the emotion is released, you will have a skewed viewpoint of what is right. Once the emotion is released, you will have a more accurate perception of what is right. It's only after the emotion is released. And yet most of us avoid the release of the emotion. And so what we're doing is we're trying to be logical, trying to be logical, trying to be logical, trying to be logical, while the emotion is still within us, causing us to be illogical. Right? Now, it would make more sense to go, okay, this thing inside of me is causing my lack of logic. Let's get rid of it. And then let's have a look at the situation again. Right? That would make more sense, wouldn't it? But why don't we do that? Because we are afraid. We don't want to feel the depth or of that hurt or of that emotion. And so what we do is we tell ourselves we can ignore it and be more logical. And that's just trying. And what has Mary said to you about trying?
Lying.
It's lying. You're just lying to yourself. So what we need to be is more honest with ourselves, more direct with ourselves, honest about the fact. If I don't see the truth of something, it's because my belief is already skewed. Right? The truth is we can grow up with beliefs of all kinds. If you've been attacked all your childhood, for example, you are going to believe that everyone in the world is out to get you. And a person can come along who's kind and good and tries to share some truth with you, and you know what? How are you going to treat them? You're going to be angry and mad with them because you're going to think they're out to get you. And until you release the emotion, everyone's out to get me, you're not going to be able to receive truth or believe that truth is ever loving if you have that emotion. Can you see? Yep. Now, I think I'm sort of getting to the edge of how long I wanted to talk about this. I'd like to... Oh, Eloise was next. And then, that was it, I think. If I can just stop there. So you're next. Fire away.
I just had a question, which I think I kind of figured, but you can, like, I think I'm pretty sure I'm woman dominated, but in some situations I feel blocked to both. Mm-hmm. And like, I feel like I don't have any logic or any beauty or form, you know? And part of that I can see I'm rebelling about.
Mm-hmm.
Is that normal?
Yeah, very, very normal. Because you think, well, you have emotional injuries towards your mum and emotional injuries towards your dad. The emotional injuries towards your mum are going to be blocking you towards femininity. And the emotional injuries towards your dad are going to be blocking you towards masculinity. The emotional injuries that your dad had with your mum are going to block you towards femininity. If you favoured your father, and if you favoured your mother, it's going to block you towards masculinity.
Yeah, you see, when you're talking about all this, I'm just thinking, well, I'm blocked to so much in so many different areas because of...
Yeah, you're totally right off. There's no chance of you ever recovering. Is that what you're saying to me, or what?
No. Is there any chance of you recovering? Okay. Yeah, I know that. Yeah. In my head. Yeah. But no, I just feel like, yeah.
Can you see that in the end, and I've spoken many hundreds of times about the intergender emotional injuries and how important they are to address for your own happiness. If you can address the intergender emotional injuries, your own happiness will increase manyfold as a result. Now, most of our injuries are intergender emotional injuries, if you think about it, because we either had a relationship or a lack of one with our father, and a relationship or a lack of one with our mother, or a distorted relationship with our father or mother, which all cause these intergender emotional injuries. So every single person on the planet who grows up in any environment is going to have injuries towards both. Does that make sense? Now, there are certain qualities that are masculine, and those qualities, if you're a block towards them, will show you what areas in which you're blocked towards your father, right? And what areas where your father hurt you. Certain qualities are more feminine, and you can feel that they're more feminine, right? And so certain qualities are more feminine, and those particular things will block you towards your mother if you have blockages towards that. And so it'll show you where you block towards the feminine. The key is to not overanalyze the whole thing, but the key is to understand that if there is no balance, whatever we're doing, singularly or with other people, is going to be out of kilter one way or the other, and you'll notice it. Yeah. And that's the thing to do. So Pete now knows, working out on the property, he's allowed male-dominated men to dominate him, right? Yeah. To make him decisions and choices, right? That has now caused quite a lot of work for him. And now he has this feeling, and Father, the feeling you voiced to me today was, I should just do it myself. And I'm going, no. No, you don't do things yourself when you can pay somebody else to do them, right? Because that's a leverage of time. You don't want to do that. What you want to do is learn how to confront the emotion inside of you that causes you to be afraid of addressing the issue and address the issue. That will either cause these men who are male dominant to leave, or they will change. They'll do one of those two things, because they'll have to leave or change. That's the only two options you've given them. If you give them the third option, which is stay and don't change, nothing's going to get very badly good very fast.
This applies totally to our relationship too, basically.
Totally.
Because at the moment there's that whole thing of do what you want, you're okay. Whereas if either of us were saying, you know, leave or change, we'd be moving a lot faster.
Yeah, well, like I've said to Mary many times, look, darling, like I love you. And I care about you, but you're pretty blocked in this particular area. And to be honest, frank with you, you're either leaving tomorrow or you're changing tomorrow.
Yeah, it's pretty good. I reckon I'll take a bit of change.
And I'm willing to put that into place too, by the way. And we have done on a number of occasions, put that into place so that certain things are worked through. That doesn't change how you feel about the person. It's just saying, see the way I see the soul is this. If I am lagging behind Mary and I'm pulling on her and wanting her to stay back all the time, then I am actually finishing up, if we are soulmates, I am damaging my own soul. What a stupid thing to do, if you think about it. It's just stupidity. If I'm doing that, I'm just being stupid. It would make much more sense to go, hang a sec, we are one soul. If I'm pulling back, on whatever issue, for whatever reason, I might be rebelling, or I might be afraid, or I might be just angry, or I might be just like scared of having a good cry, or whatever the reason is, I am delaying our progress. What a stupid thing to do. Why would I do that? Makes no sense to do that logically. Now, if Mary's doing the same thing and I'm moving forward and Mary's doing the same thing, from my perspective, I've got to say, darling, you're pulling our soul back. You've got to lift your game. Yeah. You know what I mean? And if I'm going back, I would expect Mary to say, darling, you're pulling our soul back. You've got to lift your game. Right? Because we've got to sort this issue out. And we've got to do it today. Because our soul's pulling apart. We're not going to accomplish much in that place. need to fix this today, not like, oh, I've got work today, I've got this tomorrow, I've got that the next day, I've got this next day. So maybe next Tuesday I'll give it a go. Right? How important is your soul? How important is your happiness? You know, instead of asking how important is your happiness? Well, to me it's pretty high on the list, personal happiness. So if I know, or Mary knows, that we're pulling back one half of the soul, then we've got to lift our game. And once we both understand that without any judgment, I can sit down and go, yeah, I've got to lift my game. Right? Without judging myself and without, you know, being angry with Mary that she's ahead of me or whatever. Does that make sense? I can go, I've got to lift my game here because I'm dragging our soul. Like I'm the lead weight behind the, you know, the wheelbarrow that Mary's trying to wheel, you know, in one direction. And if it's the opposite way around, then it's the same. And the reality is we're not loving each other if we're doing that to each other. It's not love to sit down, be stagnant, and to drag back the other half of your soul. That's not love. You know, that's actually being pretty nasty to the other half of your own self. Right? It's far better if both of us can work together in harmony, and when one's lagging behind a bit, we give them a bit of a word about it, you know? And if there's no judgment and there's only love, it's going to be very easy to accept, let's face it. So it'd be easy to accept. We'll work through the issue and off we go again, you know? Like, there's no harm in that. We've got to ask ourselves, when are we going to place our importance on our soul and our development of our soul towards God? They're the only two things that matter. Everything else is superfluous if you think about it. Because if we get those two things working, everything else, every other happiness is added to us. We both finish up engaging our desires and our passions. We both enjoy each other more. We're not fighting with each other because we enjoy each other. You feel more in love as you progress towards God. So the two halves of the soul, like if most of you met a soulmate couple from the celestial kingdom, you'd think they're a young, teenage, stupid, idiot couple. That's what you would think, to be honest. Because that's how much judgment you have about true love, binds. You would actually think they're just stupid idiots who are just some kind of gooey love affair. Now, I'm saying, you don't believe that, but I'm saying that's how you would see them. Because of all the blockages you have between yourself and the other half of yourself, that's why you would see it that way. You would see it like some teenage silly affair, you know? And the reality is that every celestial couple who's there in a soulmate relationship feels passionately in love with the other half of themselves. Huh? And many of you have a lot of judgment about love. Huh? You know, love is compromise, love is this, love is that. Love means that the other person's going to take me over. Love means that the other person's going to dominate me. I'm going to give my heart, the other person's then going to manipulate it. And these are all of the things that cause the separation. Yeah. Anyway, we'll talk more about it another time. But we feel that this issue can change relationships so rapidly that you can end up enjoying each other so much more, right? And if you're enjoying your relationship, you're not going to be fighting with each other all the time and making each other's life more difficult. You know, you won't be feeding the addictions of people outside of your relationship, and you won't even be feeding the addictions of your own partner. Because to do so is to not love your own soul. If I fed Mary's addictions, I am helping Mary stay where she is. Now, that doesn't make any sense. If I want to move forward, and Mary's there on this line, and I'm wanting to move forward, and yet I'm feeding her addictions that keep her on this line, can you see how counterproductive that is? It's totally illogical thing to do. Right? If I move forward, one of the things I've got to stop doing is feeding my partner's addictions. Because if I continue feeding her addictions or his addictions, he or she is not going to be able to move forward with me. So the reality is, I'm going to have enough courage to confront my partner's addictions in a loving, honest and truthful manner. I'm going to have that kind of courage. Now, if we all did that, and we worked on that over the next year, the next Summerfest, or the next Octoberfest, or Novemberfest, or whatever it is, and we would find that what we create would be more balanced. And it would be a combination of structurally functional as well as beautiful. Yeah. And we'd actually find that we can accomplish more in a shorter period of time. Because instead of working apart from each other or separate from each other or against each other and having to do things over and over again because we haven't worked together, we are working together. And therefore, everything is functionally and aesthetically pleasing. And as a result of that, we only have to do it once. Trust me, doing a job once is far better than doing it once, failing, and then having to undo it, and then do it again. Because that's doing a job three times. See, if you don't do it once right the first time, you're actually going to be doing the job three times. Sorry? You do perhaps learn from it. Well, like the worm farm, yes, you perhaps learn from it. When I say perhaps, if you block towards the masculine or the feminine and you retain that blockage, are you learning from it? The next thing you do to fix it is going to be just as structurally damaged as the first thing you did, but just in a different way. Until we are to truly learn from it, we need to address the emotional issues involved in it. Yeah. Anyway, that's what I wanted to chat with you tonight. Thank you. So what we're going to do is Fab and myself are going to do a bit of a karaoke demonstration to you. Is that all right? We've picked about 30 songs. It doesn't mean that you have to stay for them all. Right? And if Fab is a good singer, of course, but myself, well, it's not so good. So you don't have to put up with me singing badly either, by the way.